Now is always the right time. With something positive in your mind, there's always someone to pull you down.
Peace and blessings. This is Sister Ifama coming to you from the Midwest. Sit back, listen. The psych war is coming to you.
An elder man told me children today are raised like chickens thrown into the world to grow, not knowing what they need to know.
Lost. Illiterate, confused,
or which way to go.
Lost. Stumbling, fumbling, stumbling, fumbling.
Sonny said,
listen.
Lend me your ear.
Listen.
And I will make it clear.
Listen.
Crystal clear.
Planting seeds in the garden of young brains is a deep, deep thing. You've got to breathe.
You've got to breathe.
You've got to breathe.
What you need.
What you need.
Or evil will plant its seed.
You've got to breathe.
You see, man is fertile. Like earth.
Like earth. Need.
What seeds are planted determine his worth.
His
You've
word.
Got to breathe.
The cultivation of your child's mind must be done on your time.
What Not you your babysitter's time.
A chicken don't let a duck raise his chicks, making chickens act like ducks. Man must protect and educate the fruit of his own vine.
His own vine.
Or leave a generation blind.
Stumbling, fumbling through life. Stumbling, fumbling.
Fish running fish schools. And learn fish rules.
Fish rules.
Ducks quack.
Quack.
And roosters crow. Is a fact we all must know.
We all know that.
Copycat is a fact.
Na 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 na
na na na na na
na na na na na.
When it comes to things like that.
Like that.
Things like that.
When a man sows his seeds,
you've got to breathe.
He can be sure he's not getting weeds.
What you need.
Plant. God first.
God first.
God first.
Deep into the soul of a new birth.
Into the soul.
Throw righteous seeds where you see a need.
Here, there, seeds of love and care.
Plant respect and that expect.
Expect respect.
Sprinkle the seeds. Of faith,
faith.
Love,
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 love, and work
early in the garden of a young child's mind.
You've got to breathe,
and divineness,
divineness,
shall occupy his time.
What you need,
it's mine.
You've got to breathe,
you've got to breathe.
What you need.
What you need.
You've got to breathe.
Got to breathe. You gotta breathe.
What you need.
What you need.
Breathe
what you need.
got to breed what you need.
Peace and blessings. This is Sister Ifama coming to you live from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. That was the Watts Poets. The piece was entitled Breed What You Need. You know, we have some very brilliant people here in the city of Milwaukee. And one person, I was going through my archives and I dug out this little pamphlet by a brother named LaRue Ned right here in Bruce City. The title of the pamphlet is The Psych War, The Interracial Battle for Mind Control. And it's a small pamphlet, so I'd like to go through this pamphlet with you because it's very pertinent to what we're going through now. And it seems like this is something that we have been going through from day one since we've been here in this country. The pamphlet starts off with a quote from The Miseducation of the Negro by Carter G. Woodson. And it says, "The problem of holding the Negro down is easily solved. When you control a man's thinking, you do not have to worry about his actions. You do not have to tell him to stand here or go yonder. He will find his proper place and stay in it. You do not need to send him to the back door. He will go without being told. In fact, if there is no back door, he will cut one for his special benefit. His education makes it necessary." Under the heading Cause and Effect, Brother LaRue states, "Since thought precedes action, there is always a mentality or a psychology behind every system or form of government. If racism exists, there is a racist mentality behind it. Few, if any, books or articles have ever been written that say black people as a whole are doing well by American standards. There are no books or articles written that demonstrate that white people as a whole are not attempting, by action or thought, to oppress and destroy black people. Our history in America is a long one, a long struggle that is based on race and economics. There are no black leaders who will tell us that the race as a whole is doing well in America. How much more evidence do we need to prove to us that we are in some type of war? If there is an attempt to oppress us, there is an oppressive mentality behind it. From nothing, nothing comes. Self-destruction is not a natural desire. As the life force in us naturally moves us toward the perpetuation of our life and towards happiness, we are inclined to see self-destruction as coming from forces that are not natural to us. If we had known better as a people, we would have avoided the extreme hardship of the so-called slave days, as well as our present condition of epidemic levels of divorce, crime, unemployment, poverty, and death. These are not conditions that people intentionally impose upon themselves. Some of us may doubt that black people are under attack because we do not see armies moving into our neighborhoods. Yet, a psychological offensive can be just as deadly as a physical offensive. In some ways, more so. We may doubt that we are in a psychological war because we have not heard a declaration of war announced on the radio or television by the attackers. However, actions speak louder than words. we see that the overwhelming majority of black people are restricted to economic and emotional poverty. These are not conditions that we desire. It is misleading to say that black people as a whole are doing well because a few are doing well. We may see so-called progress because black people are still becoming the first black man or woman to do this and that. The schools are integrated now. We may see ourselves as being part of the greatest country in the world. We may believe that civil rights has given us even more freedom. When we see who is perpetuating all the violence and division in our race, community, and home, we see that it is mostly black people doing it to black people. The white man isn't coming into our homes and putting guns to our heads, forcing us to break up our families or kill each other. The aim in a psychological attack is to get the people under attack to work against themselves. It appears as though it is black people who are waging war on black people. Casualties of war. Although we may not see where the attack is coming from, we can see evidence of the attack by the disproportionate high rates of death, mental disorder, crime, imprisonment, poverty, division and malfunction in our families and race. Something is causing these problems to be mass-produced all across the country. Obviously, something is holding us back while the rest of America is booming. Something is preventing us from working together for our own security and happiness. We are being further divided while others are united. Under positive conditions, life develops and grows. Under negative conditions, life becomes perverted and stiffened to the point of death. When the Europeans went into Africa, they exploited the people and as many other natural resources as they could. Millions of Africans were brought to the Americas in the name of slavery. Millions died in the process. The European slave trade is noted by many historians as the world's worst period of man's inhumanity to man. What is the mentality behind such a system? Today, 500 years later, black people still find themselves at the bottom of the social ladder. The gap between the social standards of black people and white people continues to grow wider and wider, leaving black people further and further behind, with epidemic and disproportionate rates, high rates of social and personal problems. Black people who have no interest in learning about the laws of life, the development of the race, and how our minds and bodies work are victims of this psych war. Those who believe that by nature the black African is inferior to any other race are casualties. Black people who identify more with Europeans than Africans are victims. Black people who perpetuate crimes on other black people are slaves to their enemies and therefore are self-destructive, and that makes them victims of this psych war. Black people who have given up hope for their own race and families are victims. A victim of the psych war, therefore, has been mentally manipulated into working against the natural laws of survival for self and group. Just a little thought on the subject will let us know that working together increases our chances of survival and happiness. Divide and conquer. He quotes Matthew 12:25. Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself will not stand. Verse 26. And if Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? And this was supposedly said by Jesus the Christ. If problems of the race and family are not corrected by this generation, how and when will these problems be turned around? Can we expect any more cooperation from white people in the future than we have seen in the past? The psychological war in which we are involved produces casualties and disproportionate high rates of crime, divorce, poverty, and a general lack of unity in all areas. And most important, it generates a lack of love for black people by black people. The objective in a psych war, just as in any physical war, is to overpower and control or eliminate the enemy. The main strategy in bringing about this result is divide and conquer. It is universal law. Anything that works against itself or its self will not continue to exist. We have failed to properly control ourselves culturally, economically, and educationally. We suffer more because something is preventing us from doing that which becomes natural to people in general and which will improve all black people's lives. We have failed to work together as other ethnic and racial groups have. What is the source of such a mentality? The bullets. In this psych war, two of the most effective bullets used against black Africans born in America are: one, that we are descendants of a people who used to be slaves to white people, and two, that our ancestors lived like stupid animals, not that animals are stupid, in the jungles of Africa before the white man came. These negative beliefs have strong influence on our understanding of ourselves and our existence. How can a people who are not worthy produce offspring who are worthy? How can devils produce saints? If we believe that our ancestors were slaves and savages, we will act accordingly. In addition, we would be reacting to something that is not true. This is a double negative. Identification and mind control. The division that manifests itself through us is done by the manipulation of our beliefs and or ideas. If we believe that black people are inferior, we will act upon that belief. If we believe that black people will never get it together, we will act on that belief. Much of our self fulfilling prophecy is based on our beliefs about ourselves. And many of our beliefs about ourselves are based on our beliefs about our history and our true religions. The divide and conquer principle in a psych war are based on the laws of mind, thought, and beliefs which are common to all human beings. One of these laws is the law of identification. This law permeates all of nature. By the laws of identification, we accept or reject ourselves. We believe that we are worthy or not worthy. If we see the race as being negative because of its history, we will associate that negativity to ourselves, family, and friends. Or we will disassociate ourselves from the race and claim to be colorblind. Self-esteem is vital to mental health. Mental health is vital to physical health. In self-rejection, we become divided against ourselves spiritually, mentally, and physically. Negative self-image prompts self-rejection. An effective objective in this war is to have us not identify with the processes that brought us into existence, our history, and our ancestors. In order to avoid negative associations, to feel worthy, we are prompted to choose to mentally disassociate ourselves from our own spirituality, ancestors, and history because we believe our ancestors were slaves and savages. And because our history has been presented to us in such a negative way, it prompts some of us to reject education altogether. Who wants to identify with slaves and savages? Therefore, we are prompted to live according to white people's way of life. Look up the definition of the word slave in a dictionary. Ask yourself, what is the difference between a slave, a prisoner, or a captive? Just because someone calls you a slave, does that make you a slave? Did our foreparents resist their captivity? Were they totally defeated? If we believe that our ancestors were slaves to white people, we must also accept the beliefs that are related to it. For example, it implies that we submitted to the will of the European. This word implies that whites had us under total control. Another related belief is that we let them treat us worse than animals without fighting back. These are only a few of the meanings that the word slave implies. In truth, we can find nothing positive in the belief that black people, our ancestors, used to be slaves to white people. However, coming out of slavery may be seen as positive. At a time when our children are beginning to form their own self-images, they are taught that they are the descendants of slaves and cannibals. At the same time, our children are presented with numerous images of white people's genius, bravery, and conquest. So our children, in the name of ego defense, reject the whole system. In turn, this type of education has prompted division in our minds, which has led to epidemic levels of low self-esteem, low grade points, expulsions, and dropouts. A negative education is at the root of our epidemic social and personal problems. What we think and how we feel about ourselves strongly influences how we see the world around us. If the world appears to be dull and ugly, we will not likely want to learn about it. On levels that we may not understand, we are encouraged to reject the present religious and educational systems. If we see no alternatives to these systems, we may reject learning altogether. If we accept the belief, if we choose to identify with our ancestors, and if we believe they were slaves, we will automatically associate certain beliefs about them to ourselves because we came from them. We will consciously or unconsciously see that same inferiority in ourselves as either hidden or manifest. We judge a tree by its fruit, and vice versa. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, as put in Matthew 7:18 of the Holy Bible. Therefore, there is no large-scale movement to rebuild African culture in America. We call ourselves Afro-Americans. And today, and Ifama speaking, and today in 2005, we call ourselves African-Americans. When it is clear that America has never demonstrated a willingness to accept black people as equals. Our history is full of black people who have sought to move the masses to higher levels of consciousness. Yet, the problems of our race continue to get worse because deep within we believe that we are the product of inferior human beings, slaves. A slave is one who has been totally defeated. On the other hand, under extremely oppressive conditions, we can still see the genius of black people coming through. Black African and American history is full of this genius. Even today, in areas where we can compete freely, we dominate. The same genius that we use to dominate in sports and entertainment can be applied to other areas as well. And it is this genius that puts fear in the hearts of white people. And this fear motivates many of them to become racist consciously and subconsciously. Education, mind, action. All human actions are a product of the mind. Education directly affects the mind. Therefore, we should consider the fact that the public education center system has a very strong influence on the development of our families and communities. In general, the school system is trusted because it is sanctioned by the government and the general public. Most of us believe that most of what we are taught in school is true. Because of the power of the school system, a child will often take the word of the school over the parent. That is so sad, but it is true. Plus, the schools have our children for almost 8 hours a day, constantly dealing with their minds, from the first grade to the 12th grade to college. And we can also add to this what Brother LaRue is saying, is that now we have early childhood programs where our children are now going into these systems at age 3. We know this system has to have at least some influence on all our minds and in turn our actions. There are no black people born in America that have not been exposed to the Euro-American education system. The reasons why black people have never done well in the white man's educational system are real. They know what they are doing. Generation after generation, knowledge is built on knowledge. White people have learned that, like everything else in the world, the human mind functions according to universal law. Therefore, through learning and passing on information, the controllers of our education have learned a great deal about the laws of the mind. It is their job. How could they not understand what effect the Euro-American education has on the African? We have been in it for over 500 years. If it has not improved our lives as a people by now, what makes us think it will in the future? The controllers of our education know too much about philosophy, history, science, nature, and education to not know what effect white people's education will have on black people. The controllers of education are well educated in the laws of the brain, mind, and human nature. They collect information in libraries and schools. They even have special libraries on law, psychology, history, or technology. Imagine a whole building, 2 or 3 stories high, full of books on one subject. That's a lot of knowledge. Out of all this knowledge, a certain amount is selected for the public education system. And because of the similarities in schools across the country, similar effects are being produced in black people across the country by this knowledge. Teachers then reinforce the school system by teaching what they were taught. Who determines what our teachers and children learn? Who determines what subjects will be taught and how they will be taught? And how did they come to the conclusion that one certain type of education is good for everybody, black or Indian? What is the mentality behind such a system? How can we truly expect an education system that has its roots in Europe with white people to be beneficial to black people? And how can we expect an educational system that has a long history of dogging black people to be beneficial to the black people in general? In the beginning, it was against white people's laws to educate any black person. At one time, our greatest thinkers were involved in trying to convince white people that black people were human beings. Can you imagine arguing with someone as to whether you're a human being or not? Wow, Brother LaRue, that was deep. He goes on. In the 60s, we fought for civil rights. Now we say we should have been fighting for human rights. We have come full circle. When we were allowed into their systems, schools, and churches, we were segregated to an inferior status. When the schools became integrated, we had to fight for black studies. The public education system has never demonstrated any sympathy toward black people without a fight. That is so true. Today, as Brother LaRue states, we find that we have just as many problems in the school system as ever. In some cases, even worse. What makes us think that there is no relationship between the education we have received and the progress we have made? There has never been a time when black people in general have ever done well in this education system, especially since the schools were integrated. At least we might question the relationship between our children's attitudes and their education. A few black people have done well, but the majority of black people have not. If education does not affect people's actions and attitudes, then it is not effective at all. And who needs an ineffective education? Are we inferior by nature, or has our education led us to an inferior status in this society? Under the heading Reverse Psychology, Brother LaRue states that the definition of a slave is a person who has lost all freedom and personal rights, who has lost the power of resistance. But when you read about the history of black people in America, you will find that none of these definitions really apply. We have always exercised our personal and individual rights, and we have always resisted white people's attempt to enslave us. The reason why our ancestors were called slaves in the first place is because it was white people's intention to make them slaves, not that they were slaves. In getting us to believe that our foreparents were slaves, we now see ourselves as being free, when it is actually the reverse. We believe that our foreparents were freed by the Emancipation Proclamation, and that freedom was passed on to us. Yet, all the religious and cultural changes that were forced on us during the so-called slave days, we struggle to cling to today. What was the process that made us Christians? How did English become the only language we know? If slavery meant taking out the African mind and putting in the European mind, then to reverse slavery would mean to take out the European and putting in the African. If we understood that our ancestors were not slaves in the beginning, we would see ourselves differently today. Believing that we were slaves, we acted upon that belief. In the beginning, we risked our lives to get away from white people. In the end, we risked our lives to be included in their institutions. I have a hard time with that word, risks. Even though we were not allowed in their churches, we modeled our churches after their churches. We modeled our schools after their schools. At one point in time, we even stopped referring to ourselves as Africans. We had been manipulated into denying our relationship with our own heritage. The fact is that the dictionary definition of the word slave does not match the actions of our ancestors before the Emancipation Proclamation. Defending against psychological attack. The first step in defending oneself is realizing that one is under attack. The facts that the word slave and slavery are attached to our history and that we are still looking for freedom and civil rights are clear evidence that black people in America are and have been under psychological attack. Slavery is about mind control. As Woodson points out, when you control the mind, you control the body. And I heard, this is Ifama, and I heard the Dr. Bobby Wright say, when you control the mind, you control the behind as well. Brother LaRue goes on to quote out of the Bible in Mark 8, verse 36, what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? In 37, or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? Since we know that there is a psych system behind the disproportionate suffering of black people, we know we are in need of defending ourselves and our children on that level. In a psych war, the ammunition consists of misrepresentation, lies, and negative self-images. If we believe they lead to self-rejection and or misidentification, in turn, this leads to internal mental conflict and denial of important spiritual and mental needs. This in turn leads to crime-ridden, divided, and impoverished communities. In this war, there is not one black person who has not been affected in some way. Television, church, and school are all geared to influence the mind. The proper influences for black people would lead black people to work together to build an economy that would give us maximum control of our lives. They would lead us to consider the whole race and not be so individualistic. And at the same time, the race, black society, would consider the needs of its individuals. We need to build cultural centers that reflect truth and understanding about black people, where we can develop philosophies that will generate peace and harmony among us. When we do the right things, we get the right results. And Brother LaRue is so correct and so exact in his assessment of our condition and why we are the way we are. So until I get to the next topic, I'm going to take a little break and we'll be back.
Me today. You tomorrow. You watch Tara. No sorrow. Me today. You tomorrow. To those who oppress.
Yes.
And in particular, to the feel-safe looky-loos of life. Who help the lying, the cheat, beat the naive, poor, and weak.
You don't care.
To you I say, me today.
You tomorrow.
You tomorrow. Me today.
Today.
And you tomorrow.
You tomorrow.
You watch the world's war, hunger, pain, and horror.
Something
with no sorrow. Me today.
Me today.
You tomorrow.
You tomorrow.
You tomorrow.
Me today.
Me today. And you tomorrow.
You tomorrow.
You watch horror.
Watch tomorrow.
with no sorrow. Me today.
Me today.
And you tomorrow.
You tomorrow.
When a seed is planted, it starts to grow.
And grow.
And corruption not killed in the root.
And grow.
Will continue to pollute and pollute and pollute and pollute until it's absolute.
And
the wrong you do turns on you.
Send it out whack.
Cause for just a little taste of spice,
it comes right back.
And something nice.
Well,
you watch horror.
You watch horror.
With no sorrow.
With no sorrow.
Me today. And you tomorrow.
Watch the home.
You tomorrow. Me today.
Watch
and you tomorrow.
You tomorrow.
Feel safe. Looky lose of life.
Looky lose of life.
You saw the people's pain.
You watched it.
Yet you didn't do or say a thing.
You don't care.
Me today.
Me today.
And you tomorrow.
You tomorrow.
Cause when a ship is sinking,
going down,
it makes no difference if you captain on the top deck.
I'm going down.
You too. Shortly. Gon' get wet.
Just my turn.
Me today.
Me today.
You tomorrow.
You tomorrow.
You tomorrow. You watch sorrow.
You watch horror.
With no sorrow.
With no sorrow.
Me today.
You tomorrow.
You tomorrow.
Me today.
Me today. And you tomorrow.
You tomorrow.
Remember, for every beginning, there is an end.
There is an end.
To everything.
Everything.
Created by man.
Created by man.
What you do turns on you.
Set it out whack.
Kingdoms come and kingdoms go.
It comes right back.
Birth turns to death. Night to a better day. Did you hear what I say? Life just flows that way.
Going to continue with our reading of The Psych War, The Interracial Battle for Mind Control by Brother LaRue Ned. Now, under the title, God Bless the Child That's Got Their Own. In nature, no other species or subspecies of animal depends upon another species for its survival education. However, they may learn by watching other animals. The chicken does not depend upon the duck to learn how to be a chicken merely because they are both birds. The lion does not depend upon the tiger, even though they are both members of the cat family. Each animal in nature learns its survival skills from its own kind. Although they may learn from other animals, they do not depend on others for their education. The survival of the race depends upon people educating black people properly. It is important for parents and children to learn that we are the descendants of a people we can be proud of. This cannot be done by teaching that we are descendants of slaves and savages. We need to learn to love our race rather than ignore it. We need to learn about traditional African cultures and beliefs. We need to learn African languages. We need to learn about the laws of life, nature, the solar system, and universe. When we learn about these things, we learn about their creator. The laws of nature still function, even in a modern technological society. We need to learn about the laws of the mind. We cannot live in harmony with or control that which we do not understand. And if we don't control our own minds, others will. Here's a quote from Paracelsus. He who knows nothing loves nothing. He who can do nothing understands nothing. He who understands nothing is worthless. Education in the home. Almost every family can afford to purchase 2 books per month. There are hundreds of books and newspapers written by black people for black people. Many of these books have conscious expanding information. Many are full of experiences similar to and very different from our own. They are written by scholars and laymen who have spent many hours and years developing their knowledge. And we can learn from their experiences. Years and years of knowledge can be gained in a few hours or days. Through study and through thinking, we develop our understanding and become mentally strong. If we are not growing, we are doing the opposite. In a short time, you will find that you have an impressive library in your home. This is not to say that all the books we read should be by black people only. One thing that makes white people so powerful is that they gain much knowledge about many different things from people outside of their own race. Knowledge is power. We can learn from white people, but we cannot afford to allow them to be the directors of our education. There has been a book written on every subject you can think of. There is no excuse for our children and ourselves to be ignorant of African history in America and in Africa. There is no excuse for us to be ignorant of certain natural and technological facts. If parents cannot afford these books, there is the public library. In certain ways, private and public libraries are more valuable and powerful than any church. This makes having a library card more important than having a voter's registration card. Without the proper understanding, we might vote for the wrong thing. For example, busing our children to schools where they end up being the only black person in class. Parents cannot give up what they do not know, what they do not have. Parents must set the example by studying. When children see their parents reading and studying and thinking and growing, they will naturally imitate them and do even better. One thing that confuses our children is when our words and actions do not match. Parents who tell their children to study, read, and don't do it themselves are wasting their words. Knowledge is power. It is key to our defense against racism. When we do the right things, we get the right results. Black laws. Positive education for black people must be taught in black controlled schools, cultural centers, churches, etc. If the race is going to expand its consciousness, then the majority of its individuals must do the same. Stop the violence. Year after year, the black-on-black homicide rate continues to climb to higher levels. This is only the tip of the iceberg. Below the surface, we are plagued with all types of problems that lead to high homicide rates. The bottom line to this situation is that only the black community and the family are responsible for the types of individuals we produce. As a family member, that makes each individual responsible for the development of the race. Although the causes of our problems may be attributed to other sources, it is still our responsibility. All our social problems are the products of our own collective thoughts. From the so-called slave days, it was the white people's intention to convince black people that we were inferior beings. Today, many black families are still passing on that same tradition. This tradition is carried out in the form of character assassination. One version of it is known as cracking or ranking. It has evolved into a sophisticated game that many of us play. This is when one person tries to convince the other person that they ain't shit or are less than shit. It is an attempt to bring the other person's ego to the lowest state possible. Many parents use another version of this tactic in an attempt to control their children. It is so common in the black community that few people give it much consideration, and with each generation, our social problems continue to get worse. It is not unusual to hear a full-grown adult tell a 5-year-old child to shut the fuck up before I kick your ass. You are just like your no-good daddy. Are you crazy? Don't be so stupid. These are just a few light examples of the negativity that some parents pump into their children's heads daily. Often these words are accompanied by a threatening tone of voice. And it is this tone of voice or feeling that has been handed down generation after generation from the so-called slave days. It is the same attitude that the so-called slave owners used on African people. The anger of the so-called slave days is still with us. We do not treat our children in such a way before our captivity by the Europeans. When you add the negativity that the school system teaches about the black race to the punishing attitudes that are common in the black family, there is little wonder why so many black people grow up suffering from low self-esteem and internal conflict. Contrary to popular belief, verbal and physical abuse and punishment do not solve problems, but only hides them. From violence, more violence comes. It is a well-known fact that abused children often become abusers themselves. This is where the epidemic problems of black America are rooted. In a quote from the Bible in Matthew 12, verse 36, it says, "But I say to you that every idle or negative word that men will speak, they will account for it in the day of judgment." Verse 37, "For by their words they will be justified, and by their words they will be condemned." And that is supposedly said by Jesus the Christ. The threats, screaming, yelling, and the physical punishment, for the most part, must be replaced by logic and common sense. If truth, logic, and understanding don't work, nothing will. Our children need to understand in general why they are told to do and not do certain things. They are just as human as parents. They just don't know as much. As human beings, we do not possess an instinct or specific knowledge of right and wrong. It would help if parents would use their imagination to put themselves in their children's shoes. How would the parent want to be treated if he or she were the child? What would the child need when he or she gets old enough to make his or her own decisions? All the social indicators say that the black race is not making the progress it should. The responsibility, not fault, is on the parents or parenthood. Who else is really responsible for how the children turn out? We are not inferior by nature. We are all victims of the psych war in America. Our only defense and hope for victory is in raising our level of understanding and consciousness. Therefore, it is vital for all of us to study, think, and communicate. the real danger. For black people not to defend themselves in this psych war is similar to the boxer who only has a plan of attack, or it is like the chess player who moves without regard to his opponent. As all competition illustrates, defense is as important as offense. One of black people's biggest problems has been that we sought to eliminate racism without developing institutions and systems that will protect us from racism. We have been chasing the wild goose of racism for over 400 years. If we do not defend ourselves from the effects of this attack, nothing else will matter. We will find ourselves not fitting into an advanced technological society. We will become the unprofitable servant who is cast into the outer darkness. That's Matthew 25:30. This will be the basis of a physical race war in America. Black people, if we cannot carry our own weight in America, America will not carry it for us. America has not and is not demonstrating a compassionate attitude toward black people. It is looking to loose its excess weight. The country is falling apart. Black people are complaining like hell, and white people are looking for a scapegoat. If our problems in America continue to get worse and worse, it can only take us one place. Even the tiniest problem, if allowed to grow and develop, will kill. Right now, black America is suffering from negative problems in epidemic proportions in almost all areas of society. If this continues, how will we survive? When will it be turned around? Who does it depend on? When we do right things, we get the right result. Either we are part of the solution or we are part of the problem. And that is the psych wars. Now he goes into a summary and main points. And I'm going to take a little slight break, and I'll be back with the conclusion of summary and main points in the psych war by Brother LaRue Ned. Let's conclude the psych war with the summary and main points. Number one, we are under psychological attack. We are involved in a psych war whether we know it or not. The proof can be seen in the amount of casualties we see in the black community. If we do not see the attack, we will not react to it properly. It appears as though it is black people waging war on black people. If the problems of the black community continue to get worse and worse, it will end in the physical destruction of black people in America. Number two, all human action is a product of the mind. The actions of the race are initiated through the mind of the race. Self-destruction is not a part of our nature or our true mind. Therefore, self-destruction can be removed. Everyone wants to live and be happy. The mind is directly influenced by the education it receives. The education we now received is controlled by a race of people who have a long history of doing things to black people that they would not like done to themselves. White people know what effect their education will have on black people. In nature, no group or species of animal depends upon another group or species of animal for its education. It is not natural for black people to depend on white people for our education. The major influences on our minds are church, school, television, music, books and magazines, other people, and thinking. Notice, this is Ifama talking. Thinking is last. Our only defense is to take charge of our own education. Our self-education must occur on A, an individual level, B, the family level, and C, the institutional level. We need to learn about the laws of the universe, nature, science, and mind and body. We need to learn about our history in America and Africa. We need to learn about our original cultures and languages. The survival of the race and its individual members depends on this type of education. The bottom line to our physical survival and happiness is money. We must develop economic unity for black people, and not just a few black individuals. We must develop businesses that mass produce products and services that will support our own educational institutions. This is Ifama speaking right now. And what I'm saying is, this is what I was speaking to earlier, is that there's nothing that has made in Africa that's being mass produced. Everything says made in China, made in India, made in Pakistan, made in Germany, made in some place, but never does it say made in Africa. Now, one would think that Africa is capable in one of those countries there, that they're capable of setting up factories that can produce something like make furniture or just a whole lot of stuff. Whole lot of industry can be done and created up out of Africa. Okay, moving on. Number four, we must develop a philosophy and campaign specifically for black people to promote nonviolence in our families and communities, because we suffer disproportionately in these areas. Violence can occur in two ways, physical and verbal. Verbal violence leads to physical violence. How can we attack each other in the face of a common enemy? Our ability to work together is what makes us a strong and healthy people. Number five. Before the Emancipation Proclamation, our foreparents were not slaves. Therefore, we are not the descendants of slaves. Number six. If we do not turn the disproportionate suffering around with this generation, the race will not continue to physically survive. Amani na uweza. It means peace and power. And that's the end of this piece by Brother LaRue. And he has a last saying that says, blessed are those who struggle. Oppression is worse than the grave. Better to die for a noble cause than to live and die a slave. And that was a quote from the last poets. So I hope you enjoyed the reading of The Psych War, The Interracial Battle for Mind Control, by our brother LaRue Ned in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. He states that knowledge is power, and most certainly it is. So I've enjoyed reading this book, and hopefully you've enjoyed it as well. So I'd like to leave you, as I greeted you, with peace and love, and hope you'll be hearing from me soon. Take care. This is Ifama, and I've just got to say it. Be back at you. Peace.